This is part one of the PowerPoint lecture on the immune system medications. The purpose of our immune system is to protect us from harmful things. Well, here are a couple pictures of some things that can harm us. The first one is the virus that causes AIDS. The second is the bacteria that causes tuberculosis. If we would combine this with the parasite that causes malaria, we have the three big killers worldwide. You know, it's not just a few things, but it's a constant barrage of things that challenge our immune system. In addition to defending our body, our immune system helps clean up tissues, repair wounds, and remove abnormal cells, including malignant cells. But the immune system can also cause disease when it's not doing the right thing, such as with allergies, autoimmune disorders, and transplant rejections, to name a few. Most often, medications for the immune system are used to enhance or suppress our immune system. An antigen is a microbe or other foreign substance. When an antigen invades the body's response is to attack the antigen. The natural response against this invasion is inflammation, which limits the spread of microbes. Then we get the release of bradykinin, which is a vasodilator that causes pain. Complement, which is a protein, is released to destroy the antigen. And then there are three chemicals that are released by the mast cells. There's histamine, leukotrienes, which cause the vessels to dilate and cause itching. And then there are prostaglandins, whose increase makes the capillaries more permeable. They also increase pain and attract leukocytes, which are white blood cells, to the site of infection. The second phase of attack is now launched. The body secretes antibodies. Antibodies are immunoglobulins that fight the antigens. Now we have the B cells. These are memory cells and they record the attack, which guards our body against future attacks. Next, there are T cells or CD cells and they create cytokines. Cytokines cause inflammation, while others attack invaders directly. There are four types of immunity. With active natural immunity, microbes invade our body and our body fights it. Active natural immunity, and an example of this, is when an individual gets chickenpox. The infection runs its course and an immunity is now in place for future exposure. Passive natural immunity is from mother to fetus. The mother has the mumps as a child. She passes her antibodies to the fetus through the placenta. This protects the infant if exposed to mumps for 3 to 6 months. With active artificial immunity, we give vaccines that stimulate invasion and antibodies are formed. An example of this is the MMR vaccine, and it's given the body develops antibodies to protect itself from future exposure to measles, mumps, and rubella. Passive artificial immunity is when antibodies from the donor are given to an at-risk patient. This protection is temporary. For example, a child with leukemia is exposed to chickenpox and has never been vaccinated for this disease. Antibodies specific for chickenpox are given to the child from developing and stops the child from developing this disease, which would be devastating. A vaccine is a product that produces immunity from a disease, and it can be administered through needle injections, or by mouth, or by aerosol. A vaccine is the injection of a killed or a weakened organism that produces immunity in the body against that organism. Some vaccines have egg proteins in them, so allergies to eggs should always be checked. Many facilities will hold vaccines if the patient has a fever or the flu or other serious infections. Some vaccines have side effects, including fever and redness and pain at the injection site. Severe anaphylaxis is possible, and patients should always be observed for at least 15 minutes after a vaccination. Anti-inflammatory medications shut off or reduce the body's inflammatory response. These medications treat conditions such as anaphylaxis, arthritis, and colitis. They also treat autoimmune disorders where the body's immune system is attacking itself, like with Crohn's disease, Hashimoto's, and allergic rhinitis. We will review antihistamines, which block the allergic response, and nasal decongestants, which vasoconstrict the vessels in the nose, which cause the mucous membranes to shrink. We have reviewed the glucocorticoids several times now, your ONE, your number one drugs. Fluticasone or Flovent can be given intranasal for allergic rhinitis. Hydrocortisone can be given topically, or prednisone is given orally, or Solumedrol may be given IV in severe cases. Remember, these medications are anti-inflammatory. NSAIDs are non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, can be antipyretic. They can reduce fever or analgesic, they reduce pain, and anti-inflammatory. Examples of OTC NSAIDs include ibuprofen, which is Advil and Motrin brand names, and naproxen, which is Aleve or naproxen. A prescription oral medication is celecoxib or Celebrex. There's also an IV NSAID, and that's ketorolac or Toradol. Immunosuppressants suppress the immune response. Corticosteroids, as we've talked about, are one class of these drugs. Immunosuppressants like azathioprines, they work differently by disrupting the synthesis of DNA and RNA and cell division. They're used for long-term therapy of inflammatory diseases or as anti-rejection therapy for transplant patients. If at all possible, immunosuppressants are used alternatively with other therapies to prevent vulnerability to infection and certain cancers caused by long-term suppression of the immune system. Cancer is caused by a disorderly and uncontrolled division of cells. Many chemicals can trigger this, such as nicotine or alcohol. Cancer cells divide quickly and can metastasize or spread into other areas. Powerful drugs and treatments are used to kill cancer. These include alkylating agents, anti-metabolites, anti-tumor agents, plant extracts, hormones, biological therapy, or radioactive isotopes. Chemotherapy is usually a combination of several anti-neoplastic or cytotoxic medications. Many chemotherapy agents can destroy healthy cells, as well as leaving our patients immunocompromised and at risk for injury. Chemotherapy medications target those rapidly dividing cells. Many of our healthy cells, like hair follicles and mucous membranes of the GI tract, they also are rapidly dividing. So we often see side effects with chemotherapy agents like nausea, vomiting, alopecia, or hair loss, and decreased blood counts. Most chemotherapy agents are given IV. Some require the nurse to have specialized training, and some anti-neoplastic or drugs to fight neoplasms or cancer are toxic to cells and can require special handling. Well, that wraps up part one of the immune system medications. If you have any questions, please bring them to the Farm Cafe or to class.